making it so our studio is cut down to the bare essentials in what you need, you know what I mean? Like, oh, if I need that
sound. You
only
need 100 synths, really. Like, realistically, that's the maximum amount of synths you need. Probably.
If I want that sound and I know, and I want that filter, I know which synth to go to.
You know, it's testing ground in here at the moment.
Yeah.
Some people won't make the cut.
In this episode of ADSR, we are in Darlinghurst, Sydney, and we visit the nicely hidden away studio of The Fingerprints. The duo run through how they got together, the recording and writing process for their latest EP, Mao, and their remix of the presets. We go through all their gear and analog synths. They give us a sneak peek at a brand new track and a whole lot more. We hope you enjoy.
We are collectively known as The Fingerprints. Where did the name come from? Acid. A bad acid trip.
It was your name initially, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was a bad acid trip, we'll just say. No, good acid trip. What am I talking about? Fuck. I just always like hear people talking about bad acid.
You like to touch things all the time.
Yeah, it's because I like to touch stuff.
That's
like
terrific.
Leaving my fingerprints all over everything. We make... I guess you're called techno. You know what?
Like,
I don't know what we make. We just make. You know,
we just make
electronic music.
Well,
I think
playing with toys.
As you can see, yeah, playing with toys. We don't really dabble in too many things organic. Although I do have a very organic diet. Frank was actually helping myself and my partner in crime at the time, Jamie Doom, with some of the Bang Gang work we were doing. He became like our, I guess our sonic guide, where we knew nothing and he knew everything. So we'd kind of say, hey, Frank, can you make a sound that goes wee? And he'd go like, yeah, sure thing. Wee! What's the first thing? That, the 808, is that
first thing
that's
I
the oldest?
Was that when I was like 11. Yeah, I told actually the first thing I bought was a 606, which I was 11, which I lent to a friend and it got nicked. So this is the second toy.
Yeah, he's the older brother.
Older brother.
It like
it works done 80% of the time.
Yeah, it's cool. It's like, you know, if he's like, I don't want to be touched today.
It just doesn't.
He lets it know. Lets it be known.
Yeah.
But he's not like, I don't want to be touched. Take me to the repair shop. He's just like, just let me be.
Let me be for a second.
Yeah, let me be for a month.
Yeah.
A
month.
I'll come back in a month. You know, like I'm on holiday, right? Like use the 909 or something. So
yeah, and then I got the 909 kind of straight up.
These guys are like basically like there forever now. They've already, you know, they got like the get out of jail free card. Yeah, they just went like.
That Poly 61 made the cut again after I got it MIDI'd.
The Voyager definitely made the cut.
Oh, Voyager's will probably
Space
always
Space Echo,
the cut.
This particular Space Echo
hasn't made the cut.
Has got the flu. It sounds
The CE1's made the cut.
Yeah. And we think this guy might make the cut, I reckon.
I think, yeah. Only just got that about.
Because he's tiny.
2 months.
He doesn't take up. I mean, you know, the more bang for your buck, like the Digi Delay pedals, you know, like they've got a lot of bang for their buck and they're tiny. You know,
I bought that because we were using the sequencer on this guy. It's got an 8-step sequencer on it, and we're using that for the other synths. But you can't trigger it via MIDI, so we'd have to put it in time by hand.
And it's very, very,
very,
temperamental.
Very hard.
There was stage and we DJed a lot, and I mean that was my job, I guess you could call it. But now I guess it's gone back to being a hobby, and I don't do it for the money anymore. I do it because I like it, and I can play the music that we produce. I like where it's at now, where the whole the approach of DJing is at now, being able to take a USB stick and kind of go, okay, got a few things, throw it on, drop it on a USB stick and have it on the end of your keys or whatever. The revelation of a USB stick is that you can go, but then you can take a bag of records as well, and it's, I still collect records, so why the heck wouldn't I play them? Mal was actually, we got a new synth in the post. This is when we got the CS15, remember? We started mucking around with just the sounds and stuff in it, and we found this crazy sound. We're like, we'll put that down. So we put that down, it kind of made like a... That's kind of similar to that, I guess. Yeah. Anyway, it had like a kind of sound like that. And we kind of started playing around with it and tweaking it and shit. And then we decided to write some drums, which I think we wrote the drums on 808.
Always.
Yeah, always. That's dumb. We always start off with the 808. That's how we start. So we kind of like, hold on, is that working? Yeah, there you go. So we always like start off, on the 808. And we just kind of find something, whatever. Pretty simple machine to use. So we had the 808, the CS15. We just started mucking about like that. And then I remember we actually pulled out like a CDJ, you know, like just standard CDJ. And then we, what else did we do? Okay, we had the CDJ and then we found this crazy vocal sample. So yeah, they're like
Oh, that's right, they'll put on the CDJ and then pitched on the CDJ and moved around and stretched. Yeah. And then EQ'd and put out and then re-put out to the Space Echo.
808 stuff here, 808 hats. What else? See here, we've written down CS15 bass. This is the one we,
I'll say you were right.
I was right. Yeah, so this is the kind of sound that we found, and we were like, yeah, this sounds pretty crazy.
Probably a reason why you should name your track.
And then we added like another line underneath it.
So that sound was the 808 or the 909 through my vocoder.
Yeah.
I've got like one of those 70s original vocoders, this SVC 350. And so we put the drums. Yeah, so we put the drums through that.
We're going through a stage of using drums through vocoder and just like use it. It's really easy to like punch in a rhythm.
A lot of our stuff is about editing and doing lots of runs, recording lots of runs and cutting the bits out rather than playing in the bits that we want, because it's a little bit more random. There's a joy about putting stuff down to tape or to hard drive that you can't change. Do you know what I mean? It limits yourself and it makes you work a lot faster.
Yeah. I think there's a, like being able to like shut something and like with software synths, there's the it's always limitless. I think you can keep going back and keep changing stuff and keep going like, well
I can lift this filter, I can make this resonant, I can do this. Yeah. It's just way
and like sometimes I want to polish this turd and polish it and polish it until it's just still turd, you know. Is that when you've... Dude, that's why we've got the turd here. We got like, well, we know it's a turd track. He's got this turd track.
This is something about being limited. Back when I used to do stuff with my band, we only had a few synths, and it was all about knowing your synth really well and getting the best out of your synthesizer rather than just going on to something new. I mean, that was about Eno as well. Eno was used to use DX7s really well, and he'd always use that because that, not so his sound, but he just knew it very well. And I think with soft synths, you can, that's limitless. You can download, buy any new synth and go through that. If I ever use software stuff, it's always like EQs, compressors, or impulse responses off reverbs. That's what I'm really big on. Like, that's the only things I really use on software because they sound really good. But as in getting our sound, a lot of it's done in hardware before it goes in the machine. So I know we've got the sound the way we want it before it goes in the machine. And the only EQ we're using there is just to bring things up in the mix slightly. So there's never really any harsh EQ going on in the box. So with drums as well, we use the 909 quite a bit, but then those drums get layered just for an extra punch. Like, I'll layer another kick underneath the 808 or recompress, re-limit the kick just to make them sound a little bit bigger.
Yeah, but, so you can hear, I mean, I know on this like one,
the toms and all that are still pretty much the 808, but EQ'd in our RTL over here.
So, like, we'll have, like, this is actually a clap we recorded from my SP12. Which is like an old hip-hop sampler, and then we layered it with... That's all the hats that we recorded from the 808.
Yeah, but super tube-driven, so they sound a little bit kind of dirtier.
And that stuff there is 808 toms that we usually... I mean, we use them basically in almost every song, I think. And then we got this sound from the Moog as well.
Was it?
Yeah, it's from the bells in the Moog.
Oh, but it was going through that. It was going through the Logic Rhythm Mod. Remember?
Yeah, it was like 101 noise. So we like layer some stuff up like that underneath usually. It's kind of sort of like pretty light, but it fills out a bit of like the kind of the high sound stuff. This stuff was just a sample.
So we use some sampled loops sometimes.
Yeah, we sample a few loops and shit like that as well.
Not a hell of a lot though. As much as I used to.
Oh yeah. This is like a new one. We're moving in a very emotional direction.
Is this the dub?
No, this is the vocal thing. So it's kind of like a bit deeper than what we've been writing.
And then those chords I played in live on the 106, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Which is, that's a HS60, but it's the same thing as a 106. It came out with speakers. It was made for the home studio, so they put speakers on it. Which is really weird, because if you start playing bass sounds, the speakers just go... You know, like, they just... I think if you're a dance musician producer, even if you use software synths, I think you should just have a Juno 106. It's like the standard techno machine. I don't know anyone that doesn't have a 106 that writes techno. I don't know. You know anyone that doesn't have a 106? We had three of them.
Yeah. I used to be totally obsessed with the 101 when Frank first showed me how to use the 101, the full extent. Like,
it's the best synth to learn synthesis on. It's so easy. Like, if you master the 101, you're pretty much there.
Yeah.
When people say, I want to buy a synth and they don't really know how to use one, I'm always like, get a 101. So, but everyone's got a 101. But yeah, but they're $600, $700, and you'll learn you'll learn about synths, and then you can apply that to anything. But everyone's still kind of like, nah. The Juno 6 is like one of my oldest guys. That's like one of my favorites. Juno 6 down there in the corner.
But yeah, I think
the 808 you love.
The 808 I love. I could probably just live with an 808 and a 303, I reckon.
Yeah. The SH2 is something I always wanted, but I haven't really got to play with that a lot. That's kind of one of my favourites. My all-time favourite's going to be coming soon.
Which one? The Prophet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to be like my baby. I'm probably not even going to let people look at it.
Frank, myself, the Super Mario Brothers, and Vi. If you don't know who the Super Mario Brothers, they're in a group called Cosmonaut 61, which is like a Sydney techno group made of two brothers. We run a techno label with them as well. We put out two records. The first one was from Cosmonaut, the second one was from ours truly. We've got more records coming from Lightyear, Jensen Interceptor, who was actually used to be part of Lightyear. It's all pretty incestuous, you know. It's Sydney. And Word Life is made up of Kato, the larger than life DJ, and so on. But part of Frank's part-time job when I'm not in the studio with him is being the Dr. Sonic. He's engineering a lot of the music.
Well, anything for our label, really.
Anything that comes for our label. I guess we're all
quality control.
Yeah, it's quality control. Exactly. Exactly. We just finished remixing the preset's new single, Good Youth in Trouble.
Yeah, I just rewrote the bass line.
Rewrote it and added a few little differences to it and tried to come up with some sounds that were quite similar to their one, but I guess a step to the left and yeah. I guess make it sound a bit more like us. But it's a really good song, we're really excited to do it.
That guy we used in Mao, and then there's the vocoder here, which I used in Mao. What's that? Yeah, that's the SVC350, the Roland vocoder. That's Alistair's Vakers sticker collection. Jensen Interceptor's going to move in here soon, so he's going to move his studio in here. So I just put all my keyboards in here till he arrives, or he can probably use some of them since he doesn't have much.